Run it back. Run it back.
Ready?
Cue the light.
There's so many out there, you just don't know.
Which ones to watch and when to say no. That's why Ryan and
Andrew
watch
so you don't have
to.
Hello, everybody, and welcome to episode 23 of
We Watch So You Don't Have To,
the Bad Movie Podcast, starring Ryan Webb and
Andrew Price. Hey, when you reverse the names. Yeah, we're actually recording, coming to you live from Conference Room B.
Conference Room B.
No joke. We're
at my office.
Yeah. This is new. This is a change of scenery for us, and it's quite a bit more professional than any of our previous recording setups. So I don't know if you guys listen to this episode and you're like, whoa, that's way too corporate. Those guys sound like they used to do the show in somebody's attic and now they're in a conference room. You're spot on. Good for you.
I'm actually wearing a suit and tie right now.
Yeah, no, we're classing this one up.
Yeah. Tonight, we watched, or not tonight, we watched it yesterday.
Yeah, no, I mean, do we want to talk about that at all? In fact, one of us watched this.
We watched this movie in our own time.
Separately, you mean?
Separately.
First time we've done that, right?
And this movie is called...
Oh, yeah.
Santa with Muscles, starring Hulk Hogan. And we watched it in
full. And a lot of other people, by the way. It stars a lot of people.
A lot of people. We'll get into that.
Yeah.
You're able to watch this movie in full on YouTube.
That's right.
Check it out.
So YouTube. Shout out to YouTube if you guys want to throw us some sponsor money. We mentioned your name and you need a little brand recognition.
Mm-hmm. Throw us that money.
What else to say about this movie to set it up? It's 1996, Hulk Hogan, the wrestler.
Yeah.
Brother!
Brother! What else did he say?
He's like, I'm gonna totally wrestle you, brother!
Wasn't he in the Slim Jim commercial? No, that was...
Snap into a Slim Jim, brother!
Brother! No, that was Macho Man Randy Savage.
Oh. Also a great wrestler from that era. Ric Flair.
Yeah.
All kinds of badass wrestlers that came out of that time.
Mm-hmm.
He said, yeah, he would be like, it's going to be a showdown between you and me, brother.
Brother.
That, you know, that's...
Do you think he has a brother?
Yeah, it's actually Ed Hogan.
Really?
No, I have no idea.
Oh. So Hulk Hogan was kind of in his prime, I think, when this movie came
mm-hmm,
out.
Mm-hmm. Should we give a summary, or what do you think?
Yeah. Let's give a summary. This movie is about Hulk Hogan. He is a spokesman for like a protein powder or something.
I think he's like inventor as well.
Inventor?
Like, they sort of make you think that he is this bajillionaire product master when it comes to like, of course it's like weightlifting shit. Like,
yeah. Steroids or something.
Yeah. He invented steroids in the movie.
And his character's name is Blake. Thorne?
Blake Thorne.
Right?
Yeah, sounds a lot. It sounds pretty porn star-y, actually.
Yeah, Blake Thorne. And so he lives in this like huge mansion.
Mm-hmm.
And the movie kind of kicks off with him and his posse kind of wreaking havoc on the town. They get into a chase and a shootout, actually, with the cops.
I want to dive into that. I want to dive into that more, but I think we should keep moving for the sake of the summary.
And, God, how can I move this summary along? So they end up, Hulk Hogan escapes at the mall where he needs a disguise to hide from the cops. So he finds a Santa suit. And while he's at the mall being Santa Claus, he notices some people stealing from...
Well, hold on. He hits his head.
Oh, yeah.
He just had he has amnesia or something.
So he thinks that he's Santa Claus.
Well...
Kind of?
Yeah, it's weird. It's like...
Oh, okay.
He just doesn't know who he is, and he knows he's supposed to be either really Santa or a mall Santa. It's not really clear.
And then there's an elf that finds him who's trying to, like, steal from him.
Right.
They kind of pair up. And so, anyways...
He really takes on this new character, though, of being Santa.
And he's like, I've got to, like, save the kids. I've got to, like, fight crime. Santa doesn't fight crime, though.
Right.
But he starts fighting crime.
Yeah.
I don't know.
That's the whole thing. I mean, and then it's just, like, him...
Well, so he sees guys stealing it from this jar, this, like, Save the Children mission booth. Do you remember that? Where the old lady's, like, sleeping. And so he beats up those guys, but then he gets inspired to, like, save the children. Like, he's really, like, honing in on this sign. And so that causes him to kind of end up at this orphanage, which is, like, act two of the movie.
The whole thing then is really him saving the orphanage from the evil scientist who's trying to buy the plot of land the orphanage
That's
is on
right.
for a secret mission purpose that we find out later in the movie. And it's really then just Hulk Hogan realizing he was this selfish millionaire before. Mm-hmm. He got amnesia. He was a good person. And, oh, you know what? Boom. Amnesia helped me be a better person. Now I'm a good person.
Now he's a good person.
This sort of a pro-amnesia movie, actually, now that I think about it.
That's interesting.
It's like, go get you some amnesia.
And steroids. Why you get it?
Dude, if you could combine those two and you just get jacked on steroids but also have amnesia...
But you forget who you are.
You would wake up and... I mean, you'd be like... Someone could be like, you're the Hulk. And you'd be like, yeah.
Or what if you were led to believe that you were like some evil villain or something? You know? Then you could do some serious damage. It could go either way.
That's actually... Yeah.
You could either do good or harm.
You're right. There's dangers. There's dangers involved. Well, okay, let's get off of that. Let's talk about this movie, dude.
It was unlike any other Christmas movie I've ever seen.
Absolutely.
By far.
Absolutely. And it was bizarre from the start. Like, for instance, you turn it on, the actual, like, movie titles, like, the title and all the, like, cast and everything like that, it was, like, introduced in, like, weird red, like, horror movie font.
Dude, I have that in my notes. Literally, my first note says, creepy as fuck intro.
Yeah, so I was like, okay, maybe I got the wrong impression about this movie. I don't know what the deal is.
I thought it was going to have, like, a really dark tone. But that tone didn't really carry, like, all throughout. It was just...
Nope, just someone did the wrong drop down when they're selecting a font. Right.
Yeah, it was a really creepy intro because there's a girl from the orphanage who was writing a letter to Santa about this bad man who's moved into town or whatever. And that was kind of...
I also assumed that bad man was Hulk Hogan.
I thought the same exact
thing. For, like, a long time, by the way. For a lot of the movie, I was like, oh, this guy is... He's also a bad man.
Because that intro scene immediately transitions into Hulk Hogan, like, hiding in the bushes... And I thought that he was trying to take down... I thought either he was the bad guy or he was trying to take down the bad guy. But do you remember how that crazy fight scene with Hulk Hogan played out? How that was like his quote-unquote exercise routine?
Yeah.
Where he had all these people, like personal assistants, like that set up these like...
It was his staff, like his chef and his like butler. And they would all like... They were like basically trying to surprise fight him as his like morning training. But... The thing is,
he would kick their asses. Though.
Yeah, like he would hit a guy like 12 times in the movie. It was like it crossed the point of like comedic fighting to like, oh my god, like you have devastated this person. Like
he took two plates and smashed the chef's head like
against his ears. Yeah. I was like, that's
like the gorillas
vicious.
In the movie Congo. Like, just crushed his head.
I feel like they told Hulk, they were like, hey, there's going to be like a funny fight scene, and he just took it to the next level, because you can't help not, like, he's trained for that, you know what I mean? He's specifically ready at all times. You come at me, I am going to mess you up.
But he wasn't kind of like this badass dude. He was kind of this, like, goofy kind of idiot with all these, like, catchphrases.
Because he was speaking, you mean, because when he started talking.
Right. Yeah. And he had all these, like...
Rules. Speaking of rules... Do you know my favorite, like, one he delivered, not, like, from the content-wise, but timing?
Tell me.
It's when they got into their chase with the police.
With the cops in the beginning? Yeah.
Which, should we talk about that? I guess, like, he sets out with his crew from his mansion in a Humvee. He's in a Hummer. Mm-hmm. And
full like camo gear and everything, and they're wearing bandanas. Like, they're up to no good.
Yeah.
They have paintball guns.
Yeah.
And they're shooting at the cops.
Yeah. So like they're like, "Oh, sir, the cops are chasing us." And you're like, "Oh, he's this millionaire, he's going to pull over." Mm-hmm. No, he just starts shooting at the cops like he's actually... Then you're like, is he a millionaire or a dictator? I think you've crossed the line into, like, actual military dictator at that point. Like, yeah. You still have the mansion, you still have the servants, but now you also, like, are above the law. Like, in a way, you know what I mean?
It was hard to kind of get behind him in the beginning as, like, the protagonist of this movie because he was causing so much, like, damage.
Well put. It was so confusing.
Yeah. But then as soon as he puts on the Santa costume, then he starts, like, being kind and everything. And then you're like, okay, well, I like him now.
You're the best.
He forgot about the old...
Well, so real quick, before we get to the Santa costume. Dude, my favorite was he was driving the Hummer with all of his crew, like, around him. Mm-hmm. He's literally escalated this, like, police chase to a point that it is now, like, a problem. Like, there are many, many cops...
It's like 5 stars on Grand Theft Auto 5.
Absolutely.
There's, like helicopters and shit.
Next move is a tank, right? Well, he turns to the guy in the passenger seat and goes, "Rule number 21, when in doubt, get out."
Oh, yeah, get out. And then he just bails.
He jumps out of the moving car. He's the driver.
He jumps out and...
And then runs away. That was insane.
Yeah, he tumbles in the dirt and then runs directly to the mall.
This was so early in the movie that I was trying to figure out the character, and I wrote on my notes, this guy is psycho.
Yeah, he's fucking insane.
Also, you know what's funny? I just gotta add some color to this, like, whole recording, because, you know, we said we were, like, at, you know, in the conference room, yeah. And twice now we've had...
Everyone's staring at us.
Yeah, we had a lady walk by. Like, I thought she was gonna come in, like, I reserved the room. I might, if she walks by a third time, I'm gonna invite her into the podcast.
I'm worried, because I didn't actually reserve this room, we'd have to, like, carry this out.
So that's, just for all the listeners out there, we were literally, like, in a one-sided, like, we're literally, like, Exhibit B in the mm-hmm. zoo. There's, like, a glass wall. There's a glass wall, everyone walking by and looking at us. Also, they just started vacuuming the office, so,
it's a little distracting.
We'll see how that goes.
See that makes sense.
Anyways.
Wait till they vacuum this room.
I'm not stopping, dude.
That won't happen.
Promise me you won't stop.
We're gonna go straight through it. Pretend they're not even there.
Perfect. All right. what do you want to talk about, dude? Sorry, I've been...
I want to talk about... Because after he became Santa Claus, there was a lot of, like, weird shit that was happening, kind of establishing all these characters, and there was the creepy intro. So after the whole, like, Hulk Hogan becomes Santa Claus thing, it then switches over to the actual villain, which is Ebner Frost.
Yeah.
Did you get that right? Ebner?
I wrote Edward, but I think he also was nicknamed Ebner. You find out later on.
I wrote Edgar, but it's definitely Ebner.
Do you know
Ebner. Ebner Frost.
Which is such a killer first name.
Yeah. And so...
But played by a famous actor, though. That was unsettling to me. Yeah, you know? Yeah. Do you know his name?
No, I don't.
All right, I'm going to bring it up real quick. Because he's definitely an actor that everyone would recognize. He's in, like, all kinds of funny stuff. Ed Begley Jr.
Mm.
He's in
Wait, Ed Begley?
Ed Begley.
And his name was Ebner?
Like, maybe they let him come up with his own name for the
podcast.
But
he could only use the letters within his real name. That's insane.
They're like, no. But you guys know Ed Begley. He's in Ghostbusters, Pineapple Express. He's the dad of Pineapple Express. He's in Spinal Tap. Dude's funny as shit.
Yeah, he's legit.
So, anyways.
And so he's got, like, his minions or whatever. The scientists, I think they call them.
This bothers me so much.
It's crazy. There's a guy who he says is Ebner's, like, physician or something.
No.
And he's hanging this guy upside down, like, in the lawn. And he rolls up, like, a TV to this guy so that Ebner can, like... communicate with her. It was like a recorded
message. No, it wasn't recorded. That was live.
It was live.
Yeah, because he does that throughout the movie.
But it was such a shitty TV, though.
It's so funny.
But then he introduces, like, his three assistants.
They're like, it's basically, dude, it reminded me of the henchmen in Inspector Gadget 2.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
So talk about the three assistants or minions. They literally are minions. They're the movie's like wacky minions.
They're awful. So there's this like super creepy geologist named Mr. Flint, and he takes his little brush used to brush fossils and caresses it over this prisoner's face, and he goes, "You'll make a great fossil."
Dude.
So that was him. And then we're introduced to a creepy chemist with buck teeth named Mr. Vile.
Was it Vile or Bile?
Oh, I thought it was Vile.
Either way.
Either could work. And then he sprays methane gas.
Yeah, like, I think it's a fart joke, maybe.
Yeah, he was like farting the whole movie. That was a really cheap kind of gimmick. And then there was the electrifyingly beautiful Mrs. Watt.
Yeah.
Clearly
my favorite of all the minions.
And she had electric powers.
Yeah,
somehow.
She would just shock the fuck out of you.
Yeah, she was holding a rose and she made it explode by shocking it. And she goes, "Ah, spring."
This movie has so many of those moments where they have this like one-liner or this joke that's supposed to land that just, it just, it's like the air leaves the room. It's so good. I love it. Like,
the methane leaves the room.
One of those is where, like, I'm flashing forward to the orphanage now, but Hulk Hogan is sitting at the table, and they're like, "Oh, Santa, can you stay? Can you stay?" Like, and they're like, "Oh, I don't know if Santa can stay, kids. Like, it's 3 days till Christmas." Mm-hmm. And Hulk Hogan, by the way, like, already delivering his lines is kind of like, okay, this is not coming off well. Like, he's not an actor, you know? Like, bless his heart. Like,
He belongs in the ring.
He's a magnetic, charismatic powerhouse in the ring. But you put him in, you know...
He needs to be fighting people constantly, too. And he's hanging around these kids.
Doesn't work.
That's not his vibe.
At one point, he says... They're like, "Can you stay?" And he's like, "I can stay. They can't start Christmas without me."
Oh, yeah.
And then it's like, 1, 2, 3, 4. And then he goes, "Can they?" It's like, wait, we get it. Like, you're Santa Claus. They can't start Christmas without you. Like, then why did you just sit there and be like... Like, it was...
I feel like that's how he would tell jokes, like, in the ring or something. Because it's so, like, kind of fake and staged and...
Except he would end him with, "Brother!
Brother! Step into Slim Jim!"
Maybe that's why people were coming by to look, because we kept yelling, "Brother," at the beginning.
Oh, yeah. Brother.
I wish we were both dressed as Hulk Hogan right now. Fuck.
Then they'd really look at us, dude.
That would be so good, though, dude. Can you imagine bandanas... Fake yellow mustaches, sunglasses, yellow tanks.
Next time
we do a Hulk Hogan movie. Okay.
We're going to make this a Hulk Hogan podcast.
Should we move into a phase of talking about the orphanage and like stuff that happens there?
I feel like that's the next natural transition.
What were your thoughts when you saw the kids at the orphanage?
Fucking Mila Kunis, dude.
Mila Kunis, tiny little baby Mila Kunis.
By the way, shout out to episode 3.
I think it might be 3 or 4. I don't
American remember. Psycho 2, starring Mila Kunis.
Yeah, if you
check
guys,
it out.
If you guys want another podcast that mentions the famous actress Mila Kunis by these two guys, go check that episode out.
But she was like 8 years old in this movie.
But she's just like, she's literally just like a little miniature Mila Kunis.
She hasn't changed at all.
Yeah. It's crazy.
I mean, she's changed a bit.
Yeah, sure.
Anyways.
She used to wear overalls.
It's not really her style anymore.
Anyways, it was kind of mind-blowing. I didn't know she was in this movie, so when I saw that, I literally was like, whoa?
Yeah. Whoa? Yeah. What else happened at the orphanage? I mean, there was a lot of shit that...
I've got two things I wanted to say there.
Go.
One was, I thought it was hilarious that they like sat down to dinner, and the like old guy that ran the orphanage, he like ran it along with the lady
Clayton.
Yeah. He was like, "Hey, hurry up, kids! It's jerk chicken night at the orphanage."
Yeah.
And I was like,
I remember this.
"That's like Dude, those orphans are not going to like that spicy-ass chicken. Like,
no.
That's super spicy Jamaican chicken.
Regular chicken. Like, give them regular chicken.
Just give them chicken nuggets. Like, that's what they want. Yeah, you're like, hey, good news, kids. Like, it's paella night. Like, it's
they're,
time for...
They're doing it right at the orphanage. Also, the orphanage is huge, but there's only 4 kids there?
Well, remember they said this... They said, oh, we found the rest of them homes. And then that kid that was, like, always such a boring motherfucker was like... Where are the leftovers?
Caleb was a little dick. What the fuck was his problem?
He was emotionless. Like, all this stuff would be happening. And I was like, I get that he's, like, salty about not, like, being picked as, like, the, like, you know.
We should introduce the kids. So there was Caleb, yeah. Who...
He's played by somebody else, like, that's an actor, but... Yeah, I mean, he's a famous kid actor from the 90s.
Yeah, I definitely have seen him in other movies, but he was kind of, like... The kid, the super unhappy, kind of mopey kid. And it's like, okay, what the fuck is your problem?
Yep.
And then there was Mila Kunis.
Cheer up, you orphan.
Yeah. Jesus.
Sorry.
I don't know if you were saying that to me or to the... It's like, God damn it.
What's this funny that we're just ragging so hard?
Yeah, perk up, you fucking orphan.
What do you have to be so sad about?
Oh.
Go ahead.
Please edit that out. And then there's Mila Kunis... Who becomes best friends with Hulk Hogan. She's kind of bright and cheery. And then,
she's also like a killer seamstress.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
She redoes his whole outfit.
Mm-hmm. So.
And then there's Elizabeth Bentley Walsh.
Is that the one who sings, she's got the voice of an angel?
Yeah, she's... Are you saying that she sings a song called She's Got the Voice of an Angel? Or are you saying that she has the voice of an angel?
She has the voice of an angel.
Both are incorrect, actually. She has a terrible singing voice that we find out about. Actually, in fact, if you stick around for the outro, you'll hear exactly what we're talking about, because that's the outro for this episode.
She's just singing the whole time.
Yeah, she's cheery. You know, she likes to keep a positive disposition. Probably because that fucker Caleb keeps things so salty. You know, she's got to cut through.
And then, we'll post a clip, but she's singing in the church... And she's so happy. She kind of does her own thing. She's like, fuck everybody else. I'm just going to be singing.
Yeah.
If people want to join me, that's cool. I'm going to be over here singing.
She's like the lovable idiot. Yeah. Caleb is like the downer. And remind me of Mila Kunis. Mila Kunis. Let's just call her that.
Mm-hmm.
She's sort of the wily, like, down to earth. Like, yeah, no, I totally get it. Like, right. She's there.
Yeah.
Those
are the kids. There's only 3 kids. Was there a fourth kid? How about little Tommy?
No.
No?
No. No more kids. What else? What else do we want to talk about?
I want to talk about the vacuum that's happening right now.
Dude, I'm kind of hoping that the vacuum, like, because we're talking so much into the mic that you can't hear it, but that might... It might sound like there's just us running a vacuum while we... do a podcast, which is what's happening.
Yeah.
I can't wait to hear
it. I didn't expect that, so that's interesting. So, the scene where they're at the church, and they go to, like, the basement of the church,
the
they're,
church
like,
is,
exploring
the church
something?
Is adjacent to the
orphanage. Yeah, it's,
orphanage.
Like, attached to the orphanage. It's
right.
All this one, like, kind of huge building. They go downstairs. What are they doing downstairs? They're just like looking around or something?
Well, no, here's what happened. For some reason, Hulk Hogan... Oh, okay, I know what happens. They know that the scientist guy is interested in... Because he's like... Basically, that scene you referenced earlier when he was like hanging the guy upside down and like threatening him.
Mm-hmm.
He was trying to convince this guy to sell his shop because he's going around and systematically buying up all the businesses in this part of town.
But
so
why?
Well, you find out but why.
Yeah, okay, yeah.
Do you not know why? Okay. All right. I'll explain this to everyone listening to the podcast that hasn't seen the movie.
I'm with you guys on this one.
Yeah, perfect.
As a patient listener.
So, Hulk, you know, being the genius that he is like, hold on, what if what he's interested in is not the land, but what's below the land? So then he was like, hey guys, what's below this orphanage? And they were all like, power lines? Some wires? And, like, after giving, like, 6 answers that are like, yeah, those are things that are all below, the mom is like, oh, yeah, the catacombs.
Oh, my God.
And, like, yeah, the kids play down there and, like, use it as their clubhouse. I'm like, By the way, if someone asks what's underneath your property and there are catacombs
don't
underneath
there... Don't let kids play down there.
A, and B, when someone says what's underneath there, that's your first answer. Not like water pipes, power lines. No, literally like a system of intricate tunnels that
like
the kids play in.
Like a fucking labyrinth. Like yes. Made out of like bones and skulls and stuff.
That's not your like eighth or ninth answer. It was just insane. But yeah, no, that's what that is. And the kids play down there. And what Dr. Frost wants is inside that area. And you know what that is? It's...
the crystals, the quartz crystals.
Magical, exploding, magic crystals.
Yep.
Or something. For some reason.
Yes. He's going to want some of those.
That's all we know. I mean, that's all I know.
That room was fucking crazy, dude.
It was cool. I mean, I would play down there.
Yeah, I would as well.
I like the combination of the lock that was like 8, 16, 24. It's like, okay, these are all, we get it. Like,
I missed that part.
We didn't like fully talk about this in the beginning of the podcast, but
you can't talk about the scene where I fell asleep though.
The scene? You're making your life a movie?
No. So back to that lock combination scene, what was that all about?
Oh, well,
16. Like, well, what was the relevance?
The kids, one kid, there's three kids, each of them had figured out one of the parts of the combination just from trial and error or something. Mm. I don't know, it was insane.
Okay.
And then the Hulk heard that and realized that he knew the rest of the combination for some reason. I don't know.
Oh, but do you know why he knew the rest of the combination?
Because he owns the vault or something?
No, dude. Did you watch the end of the movie? I just watched it, so it's fresh.
Because he played there as a kid!
Yes! Whoa.
Oh, I didn't put that together. Once again, this stupid movie's smarter than me.
This happens every time, dude.
Oh, they're about to vacuum right next door, dude.
It's fine.
Every freaking time. It's clearly picking up, dude. Where we're at. Oh. So what you're referencing is that Hulk actually...
Mm-hmm.
At that point in the, like, basement of the orphanage, like, at the vault of the catacombs...
Mm-hmm.
I can't believe I said that sentence, by the way. But he was, like... That's when he kind of was coming out of his amnesia a little bit, and he was like, oh, I remember who I am.
Oh, so you're saying he didn't remember because of the amnesia?
No, I'm saying that he... Well, he didn't remember... Yeah, right? Like, that's why he didn't remember who he was. At this point, he still thinks he's, like, some mall Santa. He doesn't know he's, like, a super millionaire bodybuilder.
See, at this point, so deep into the movie, I kind of forgot about the whole amnesia thing, because I thought he was just like...
You had amnesia about the amnesia.
Oh, ho, 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 ho.
I like that Christmas touch. No, but the whole thing you were referencing was that he realizes at this point that the reason he knew the combination was that he, in fact, as a child, was an orphan.
And who else was an orphan?
You say it, dude. You have to say it. I can't.
Well, let me make sure I wrote his name down right. Ebner Frost.
This was a huge twist, by the way.
This is a big twist. Because he finds a picture... He's talking with Clayton, and he finds a picture... Wait, was...
Clayton knew.
Clayton knew about it the whole time?
He had a sit-down. He might have been asleep for this part, but he had a sit-down, and he was like, hey, like, I know who you are. You know who you are, right? Clayton knew.
Okay.
Clayton knew. Dude... Since we're talking about Clayton, the scene where they almost run Clayton over, where the henchman...
Oh, yeah, but you know what? Hulk Hogan stopped. Dude, that scene was intense because the truck was going faster and faster and faster.
They were legit going to run that dude over.
Going to hit and crush this guy.
Also, from a long way away, I feel like Austin Powers, he was like spinning his arms no! But that's where I was like, dude, anything's possible. Like, I don't know what this thing's going to do.
And how do you think that truck got stopped?
Hulk Hogan just freaking literally grabbed it by the tail.
He had a giant chain somehow latched it onto the truck. Or was the chain already
attached?
The
chain attached? Was on there because they were like tearing off this... They were ripping up the orphan statue.
So, oh,
like,
you're right.
They were trying
to... Okay,
like,
so
They're trying to intimidate these orphans.
Wait. So when this truck is going like 50 miles an hour, Hulk Hogan just snatched this chain off the...
Yeah. That's... His hands would be shredded. And his arms would be ripped out of the sockets.
Yeah, he'd be dead by now.
For like, sure.
What the fuck?
No, dude, he's...
Oh, but you know what? He's got the steroids. He just had more, like, Blake juice or whatever, and he's good to go.
You know what those juices and powders and stuff are also good for?
What?
Getting away from the cops, as mm-hmm. we saw at the end of the movie.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, he did.
Like, did you see this part?
About them. Yeah, I did.
Where they literally poured the liquid, like, supplements on the ground, and the cops were, like, spinning out because of it?
Yeah.
Do you didn't think that was insane?
That was pretty crazy.
It was I think it was salad. I think it was salad dressing at one point.
Salad dressing?
I think he had some salad dressing brands, and they were dumping salad dressing on the ground, and the cops were spinning out.
That cop was just so... He was an idiot. By the end of it, his car was just, like, the frame, and then that was it.
It was Ron Howard's idiot, or his ugly brother.
That is Ron Howard's brother.
Yeah.
Who plays these, like, goofy roles in all these, like, shitty movies.
Did you say goofy or ugly?
Goofy.
Oh, yeah.
Ugly Ron, Jesus. Well, he should have been an orphan. He should have been the fourth orphan.
Maybe he was, dude.
Wow.
I don't know how that works. I don't know how that one would play out. Remember when the henchman doctor was trying to, like, have sex with the lady that owned the orphanage?
Yeah, I didn't like that. And he, like, kissed two fingers and, like, blew that at her.
So gross.
And he also sprayed, like, Banaka in his mouth. Do you remember that?
Yeah,
mouth spray?
Ugh.
Banaka? Is that still a thing? Do they still have that?
I don't know. Kind of want some now. That would be a classy move.
Banaka.
Spray a little Banaka.
This episode brought to you by Banaka.
Yeah, Banaka, if you're out there,
mm-hmm.
I think you might be interested.
But he was kind of like grossed out when he did it, though. Do you remember?
Yeah.
Maybe he accidentally grabbed the methane spray from his buddy, Mr. Vile.
That's probably.
And maybe that's why the lady didn't like him, because he has poop breath.
Yeah. And because a quality product like Banaka wouldn't do anything other than make your breath smell minty fresh.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. And get you ready for your date, your big interview, or maybe you're just going home for the holidays to visit the family.
Mm-hmm.
Banaka, there when you need it.
When you need it. We're going to get them as a sponsor.
I was just jotting down a note. Email Banaka after this. Speaking of, you know when he was, so when he was trying to get with that, the lady that ran the homeless shelter or orphanage.
I think her what was her name? Leslie something? I have it written down. Leslie Morgan.
Leslie Morgan, two first names.
Just so you know.
But he was like, ooh, you're a different person when you're away from those homeless little losers.
Wait, she said that to the scientist?
No, the scientist guy said that to her.
Oh, yeah. Okay, what? Sorry. I was imagining her saying that to him, talking about, like, his assistants.
No.
Like Mr. Vile and Miss Watt.
No.
Like
she
homeless little
He
losers.
Was talking about the little kids. And that's I was right. like, dude, that's...
In front of their faces.
I know you're a villain, but, like, you're calling them homeless little losers? Like, that's not accurate.
He was so creepy. He was like, how's the relocation going? Do you need any help? And she was like, get away. You're so creepy.
That was pretty solid. What do you think, dude? What else you got?
Dude, Can we go back to the amnesia scene
mm-hmm,
where
mm-hmm.
he becomes Sansa? And we didn't really talk about this, but
yeah.
the elf buddy played a big role in this movie in that he was trying to steal from Hulk Hogan the entire time. So he found him, like, in the trash can, basically. Like, down the trash chute, and he was like, oh, another drunk Santa. And he, like, searches him, finds his wallet, and sees that there's, like, several hundred dollars in there.
Mm-hmm.
Checks his ID, sees that it's the famous Blake Thorne, and he goes, Blake Thorne, the richest man in 10 states?
Yeah, I thought that was...
Wow, what a weird thing to say.
You're right. Like, what is the designation of these 10 states? It's like, I wish, damn. Okay, so where are they located for this movie? Do we know?
I've figured, like, California or something. I don't know.
The richest man in the Southwest?
It could be. Wait, so if you're the richest man but only in 10 states, then it's like the bottom 10 states?
Maybe that's what I'm thinking. Like, yeah. I'm like, maybe he's the richest man but in like 10 choice states that aren't that rich.
Right, like Rhode Island or something.
Now you're putting off all over
you. Okay. Should I not name?
Also,
I was just thinking of like a teeny tiny state.
I think Rhode Island is rich as fuck,
though. I know, New England. Yeah, that was a bad example.
That whole area. You go to New York, you make some money, and then you move right to little Rhode Island, little Massachusetts, little wherever. But New Hampshire, those guys got some money.
Hmm. You pick a state.
I'm not trying.
I don't know. It's just size anybody.
No, but you're right. I think, dude, that's one of many like weird lines where it's like, what are you going? Like, why? Like, this is your movie. You created this thing. Why don't you say the richest man in California or the richest man in? Like,
it was just
pick whatever you want.
It was a weird thing to say, but then the elf kept talking, and Hulk Hogan started to kind of like regain consciousness. And the whole time I was like, just run away, dude. Like, you've got his wallet. Like, just run. And he was like, I'm really gonna go. Merry Christmas! I can't wait to... And he's, like, just taunting and pointing at Hulk Hogan for, like,
that guy's,
5 minutes.
That guy's actually a famous actor as well.
Yeah, he was in Home Alone.
Oh, was he?
I believe so. Wasn't he the dad in
Don
Home Alone?
Stark?
Hmm.
I don't Could think he's... The, he's not the dad in Home Alone. That's gonna blow my mind.
He was in Honey, We Shrunk Ourselves. I remember that as a fact.
He's in that... He's Bob... In that Sony show. Is it Bob?
Did you just make that up? Bob?
Bob?
Bab.
That Sony show, he plays... Yeah, he's Bob in that Sony show.
Yeah. There you go.
So you guys know.
Yeah, he's been around.
I'm assuming that everyone knows all the same references that I do, so...
But that's a popular show, I think.
Yeah,
that's
fair. But he plays a very cartoony role. Like, it's like...
But the whole time... He's, like, going to the ATM, and he's really just trying to steal.
That part was annoying me so much, because the ATM, he put the card in, and he was like, ooh, goody, 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 goody. like, he's like, ooh, I'm gonna steal all this guy's money, money, money. Mm-hmm. He's, like, saying stuff like that, like it's a freaking cartoon.
But he didn't know the pin, like, why
no,
couldn't
no, no.
he get the money?
No, 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 he couldn't get the money because the ATM required a thumbprint. Do you not remember that?
No, I do, now I remember. Now I remember.
Sorry about that.
An ATM that requires a thumbprint in 1996?
That's what I didn't understand. We don't have that level of sophistication today.
Why didn't they just make it like a normal pin? You have to type in your 4-digit pin.
Yeah, like...
And then he just didn't know the pin.
Right. And he tries to guess it, but like, oh, he gets it wrong, whatever.
But it had to be a thumbprint scanner?
That's what makes me think, like, that was one of many things that, like... The movie was leaving all these little breadcrumbs. Like, I don't think this was... When they said the richest man in 10 states, it's like, maybe this is like a post-apocalyptic movie, and like, there's only 10 states left.
Oh, that's interesting.
Because you got weird, futuristic ATMs, mm-hmm. but the whole, like, reality of the movie seems pretty basic. Like, it's like, basically, like, 1990s. But then you got some other weird things that don't add up, like, the cops are using rocket launchers. Do you remember that?
Yeah.
I was like, oh, I think this is like a militarized like police force
mm-hmm.
post some fallout. They have cars that like look like cop cars from a small town in the 1970s, but they're equipped with rocket launchers. Like, there's so many things that don't add up.
It seems like total anarchy, and then like this Frost guy is like acquiring plots of land and stuff.
Exactly.
Like,
if we went back and watched it a second time, we might be able to figure it out. But we'll leave that to you guys.
Yeah.
Well, actually, no, because you're not going to watch it. We said not to.
Yeah. We watch, so you don't have to.
Shameless plug of the show you're already listening to.
That you're already listening to.
What else we got? I feel like we kind of covered it all, dude.
I just didn't understand the plot with the elf. Like, he was just trying to steal the whole time. But at the end of the day, like, he was just, like, everyone rallied around him, I guess.
Like, Blake Thorne really forgave him way too easily. Like, I don't think he should have... Like, I get
did
that,
Blake Thorne ever find out?
Yes, he did, but, like, he was totally okay with it, and it was really bizarre.
See, old Blake Thorne, before he became Santa Claus, would have beat the living shit out of
this guy. Oh, dude, if he treats his hired help, that are sort of his pseudo-friends, like he did in that opening scene where he beat them to a bloody pulp, imagine what we'd do to some shrimp of an elf. That he found out was trying to steal his money. Dude, I don't even want to know.
Bob from that 70s show.
I don't even want to know. He would have literally... I think he probably would have just literally like ripped off all of his appendages and just thrown him 100 feet
into a bush with his Santa hat.
That's how the movie ends.
That's how the movie ends. Not half of that is how that movie ends.
Everything I said didn't happen. Everything that Andrew said is how the movie ends.
He throws his Santa hat behind him.
And then we do a slow...
Yells, ho, ho, ho. And a slow zoom in on the...
Slow zoom in all the way to the Santa hat. Uncomfortably slow and continuous until you get to the point where it's locked on it. Credits.
Credits. Just a big fuck you. A holiday fuck you. Yep. That's... I don't know. What else is there? I think we did a really good job.
I think that's it. I think we told you everything.
But
what was your favorite part of the movie? Like, what's one thing you liked? We always are so negative on this podcast.
I liked... there's this one scene in particular. I think I might have a clip, actually.
Show it to us. Tell it to us. Play it for us.
It's the scene in the church where the songbird is singing her heart out. What's her name again?
Elizabeth
Hurley Jr. or something.
Dude, don't even get me started on Elizabeth Hurley. Elizabeth Hurley, if you're listening,
send
me an email through the contact page of our website. All right. No, Elizabeth Bentley Walsh.
Yeah. So she's singing in the church, and just to set up the scene before I play it, and Hulk Hogan kind of comes across her and decides he wants to sit down and join her for a bit. And so here's that scene. Enjoy.
Song, yeah.
Do you know it?
Start me off.
I'll always remember the time I spent with you. November, December, April, May, and June. You are my angel baby. You're so fine, angel baby. My pearl of time.
Yep.
There you go.
That was my favorite scene. She said that when she sings, the fairies in the window act up or something. What did she say?
Andrew's showing a clear grasp on this movie's content. Hey, look, you know what? I think we were already kind of wrapped up at that, or we already kind of put a bow on it. Something got to me when that song played. I just want to say, all of you listeners out there, we've been doing this for like a year now.
Yeah,
sure. And we've got a lot more exciting things in store.
Mm-hmm.
Anyways, you guys out there are really our angel babies. So shout out to you.
Yeah.
And yeah.
From the Bad Movie Podcast. We don't have, like, a sign-off phrase.
No, we don't. All right.
Until next time.
Catchphrase. Try to force a catchphrase.
I don't like that.
Hey, if you guys have ideas for a catchphrase, send it to us, because we need one.
Mm-hmm.
Until then, thanks for listening. And we'll send you out with some, as usual, we'll send you out with some tunes.
Mm-hmm.
So, that's where you do your catchphrase, actually. That's why a catchphrase is good, because you can just boom right.
Merry Christmas and happy holidays.
Terrible. C minus.
Time.